Good morning.
Welcome to Sunday service. I am so happy to see y'all.
Yes.
I am, y'all don't understand how it feels sometimes to just come into a place where everybody loves you, everybody's welcome, and everybody really cares about you.
Amen.
And there's not a Sunday when I come in here that I don't feel that, and I'm quite sure you all feel that from the other people. So I want to just jump right on in. We're going to open in prayer, and then I have something that I would like to share with you before we all get started. So if everybody could please just allow yourselves to just relax. Allow yourselves to be open to hear what the Lord has for you today. So, dear Lord, we thank you for allowing us all to be here in the land of the living. But we thank you that we are in our right minds. We thank you that every single organ in our body is operating as it has intended. We just thank you for Perfect World Ministries. We thank you for our church.
Yes.
We thank you for each and every church.
Thank you, God.
We understand that everyone brings something unique and special to the table. Thank you for the way that you have orchestrated us and weaved us together so that we're able to support one another.
Yes.
We thank you for our viewers who are watching us online. We just thank you for the body of Christ. We thank you that we are able to work together to fulfill your purpose. And Lord, we thank you for those that you haven't even sent yet.
Yes.
We thank you that as we continue to love on each other, that other people will be desiring to see what you have given us, and we'll be able to just share that with them and grow your body.
Yes.
Lord, we just ask that you prepare the hearts and the minds of the people to receive what you have given to your servant who will stand before us today, who will feed us your bread, and we will all receive it and take part of it and enjoy knowing that it's been sent from you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So, as I was preparing to stand up here today, I went and I stood in the prayer room and I just asked God, what is it that you want me to share with your people to encourage them?
That's right.
So I just want to take a moment just to give you some encouragement. So immediately I was in the book of Jeremiah at the beginning. And I've been having a lot of encounters where people don't really know what God wants to do with them and with their lives. And yes, we try to follow paths because we think that that's what we're supposed to do. Like, you know, we're all taught we're supposed to go K-12 for school. And then once we graduate from high school and it's no longer a requirement, everybody's trying to scramble and figure out what their calling is, what their purpose is. Because no longer is it regimented the way that it is when you have to go K-12. And some people find out their calling early. Some of us, we still have different encounters before God reveals it. But our problem is we all think it needs to be revealed at the end of 12th grade. And we get frustrated with ourselves. We get frustrated with people when they have no idea at the end of the 12th grade like what it is they want to do or what they're calling them. And some of us, and you can read in the Bible, where they didn't get their calling until later on in life.
Yes. Yes.
Huh.
It doesn't mean that God didn't call them.
Huh.
Right,
I'm a witness.
I don't know why this is where he's going, but we want to just prove it. So in Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, it says, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you."
Yes.
"Before you were born, I set you apart."
That's right.
And God showed me the Creator doesn't create something and not explain its purpose.
Come on. Come on.
The Creator does not create something and not demonstrate how it operates.
Thank you, Jesus.
So as you continue to read through Jeremiah, we get to verse 7. It says, you must go to everyone I send to you and say whatever I command you.
That's right.
Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord.
Yes.
But then when we go down further to 17, it says, do not be terrified by them, or I will terrify you before them.
Wow.
And then we go down to 19, and it says, they will fight against you, but will not overcome you.
Come on, God.
For I am with you.
Come on, God.
I will rescue you, declares the Lord.
Thank you, God.
Yes. Yes.
As I was reading this the first time, I wrote down, what can change the outcome?
God.
Yes. The outcome can't be changed because it was decided before he formed you.
Come on. Come on now.
What changes? I had to go back and put the little, what is that? This is like the carrot. Where you write something out and then you gotta come back and insert something.
Yes,
and then I then wrote, what can change how you feel before the outcome?
Oh my God.
That's the confidence.
Joy.
Knowing that
joy.
Before he formed you, your purpose was decided.
Oh my God.
And how you feel determines whether you're going to be terrified by the circumstance.
Okay. All right.
Or whether you're going to, it says, do not be terrified by them, or I will terrify you before them.
All right.
But it doesn't change the purpose because of how you feel.
Well.
And that was so enlightening to me because the in between is the part that we all hate. God will give us a promise and he'll start revealing our purpose, and then we hit the in between.
Yes.
And in the midst of the in-between, we start dealing with our emotions and our feelings.
Yes.
But the purpose is already decided. It doesn't change because of how you feel.
Thank you. All right, this.
So I just came today because I really wanted to encourage y'all. Really short and sweet. Don't know how I do it. I can keep it real short and sweet.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to let y'all know that the purpose doesn't change.
How?
Have you purchased something and it didn't come without instructions? Why? Because the person who created you wants you to understand how to operate it.
Come on.
They want you to understand why they created you. That's right.
Come on.
This is the manual that's in the box.
Yes. All right. Yes. I believe it.
It's the manual that's in the box. It shows you the purpose on why the creator created you, but it also shows you how to operate it.
All right.
So, I hope that everybody in the midst of trying to figure out their purpose understands you don't have to figure it out. The Creator already decided for you. All you have to do is operate. So, read the book.
Check the Becky.
Figure out how you're supposed to work it. But.
Amen.
We are going to bring up our praise and worship team.
Hold on. Time out.
You've got to have praise for us. So it has been 3 years and 4 months. And as minister was just speaking in Revelation, it is said in chapter 2, verse 4, this thing I hold against you. He was talking to the church of Ephesus, that you forsaken your first love. Sometimes we got to get back to where we started.
Amen.
Right? And so I'm going to make an executive decision today to get back to how we started. Now, if you don't feel comfortable, then you don't have to. But for about a minute and a half, we're going to get back to what we used to do. We're going to greet each other. Amen. So that means y'all can get up if y'all feel like it. Y'all don't have to, but back in the old day, when we first started the church, we say, let's greet our neighbors, because sometimes, let me say this, y'all don't understand what it feels like sometimes to just get a hug. To just get a hug. Some people don't get anything. So just to get an acknowledgement that you're here. Amen. This is how we started the church, and it's been 3 years, 4 months. COVID is behind us, out the door. You don't feel comfortable, you don't have to do it. But for about a minute and a half, let's greet each other. Amen. I'll come here, girl. That's a bad boy. I ain't gonna mess with that boy. He's a bad boy last night. That felt good, Minister. It felt good to get back. Yeah. Bless us, choir.
Amen. Good morning. How excellent is the name of the Lord. When you call upon the name of the Lord, healing occurs, the atmosphere shifts, people are transformed and renewed and delivered. And so we're grateful to God that his name is excellent. Amen?
Amen.
next song, we're just going to appreciate God's presence and let the Holy Spirit and the atmosphere, you know, take hold and just enjoy the song. It's called I Love You by Fred Hammond.
You are worthy, Lord.
voices.
I love you, Lord. I love you.
Sing, y'all.
I love you, Lord. I love you.
Yes. Thank you, God.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah.
All right, the next song is called Famous For, and I hope it speaks to you the same way it speaks to me.
Yeah, you got that right. That part. That part.
Oh,
doubt.
No fear.
And God is just so good. And all we know is that it's all done in Jesus' name. Yes. It's not done in my name. It's not done in your name. It's not done in some celebrity's name. It's not done in some politician's name. It's all in the name of Jesus, the all-powerful name of Jesus. Yes. When we declare the name of Jesus, things change. The atmosphere changes. Our situation changes. And you may not feel the immediate change, but God is always working on our behalf. Jesus.
Amen.
And when you don't know what to say, call upon the name of Jesus.
Call his name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Y'all can clap with us and join us.
Oh,
That's not.
Submit your tithes and offering online. You can do so at perfectworldministries.org, or you can send them in via mail to Perfect World Ministries, P.O. Box 823 in Bear, Delaware, and the zip is 19701. I do just want to remind you, we are approaching our 20th year church anniversary.
Yes! Yes.
And everything that we have been able to achieve as a church.
Yes.
And we just want to celebrate. We want to celebrate our pastors. We want to celebrate the work that they've done. We want to celebrate everything that we have done collectively.
Yes, yes.
But most importantly, we want to celebrate what God has done.
That's right.
Yes.
It's been 20 years and we've seen him come through in so many ways.
That's right.
So if you would like to celebrate with us on September the 30th, tickets are still available. You can see me after service. And I'll be very happy to accommodate you. At this time, we are going to prepare ourselves. So,
birthdays.
Okay. We are going to bring up our birthday lady, and then after that, we will dismiss the children from Children's Church.
Amen.
Sister, if you could.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Ain't nobody do you like Jesus. You heard me?
Hey. You heard?
I'm so glad to be here this week. I thank God for each and every one of y'all. My heart just bubbles over when I get in the house of God.
Amen.
So this morning, we're going to celebrate Evangelist Dolores Christo's birthday.
Happy birthday! Amen.
At this time, we are going to dismiss our children for Children's Church.
Amen.
So all children under the age of 12 are welcome to follow. So as the children are preparing to go and learn more about God, we are also preparing to do the same. So at this time, we are going to, I just ask that everybody prepare your hearts and minds to receive what God has prepared for us.
Yes.
Amen.
I believe that there's going to be something in this word that is for each and every person. So be open to hear what he has to say, but not only be open, be prepared to put it into practice and operation.
Amen.
And at this time, we will bring up the woman of God.
Amen.
Bless us, pass. Bless us.
Gracious God, we come before you today. We say thank you. We honor you, we praise you, and we lift you, God. We're grateful for all that you are and all that you've done concerning us. And Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that as this word goes forth, that it will provoke some to move in the direction that you are leading them, allow some to get clarity about the direction to take. And those of us who are on the path, give us the stamina, the power, and the perseverance to continue forward in the work that you called us to. We bind the enemy, every lie, every trap, every snare, every hindrance. And Lord, we say that we are overcomers and we will overcome everything that comes our way because you are with us. You stand for us. You push back the darkness. You light up this kingdom and it will not be shaken. So we declare in the name of Jesus, your will be done in us, through us, and for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So I want to go back to the book of Acts. We've been in Acts since the beginning of the year. God has given me that to share with you because we are talking about the missional church. We're talking about the importance of what God set up when he began the church. We are able to read the pages of scripture that will give us insight and understanding into what this thing called faith is, into this gathering and assembly, into us being the church. And so I want to continue talking about the missional church. It's a divine mission that's been given by God. And that mission is simply, it's marked by community. And so I want to just go with you on to the pages of scripture, Acts chapter 2, down to verse 41. And when you are there, say amen.
Amen.
So Acts chapter 2, verse 41. And we ended last time with the first sermon that was preached at Pentecost. And it says, so those who received his word, speaking about the word that was preached by Peter, baptized, they were baptized, and then there were added that day about 3,000 souls. And so we talked about the fact that our job is to win souls. And the word is powerful in that the word will cause those who don't know him to come to know him. And so today I want to start with verse 42, and it says, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And all came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together.
Yes.
They had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all people. And the Lord added to their number. And the Lord added
to their
number.
And the Lord
added to their number. Day by day, those who were being saved.
Yes.
The word of the Lord. And I share that with you today because the Holy Spirit has been poured out upon the people. Jesus fulfilled the promise that he gave the disciples. He said, I'm going to be going, but I'm going to leave a comforter for you. And that gift is the Holy Spirit. And the people experienced not just physically, But they saw, they experienced, and they heard the move of the Spirit of God being poured out into the earth. And they experienced the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Now that that has been done, the message has been preached, people's hearts have been pricked, they've been moved to repentance, and they were given the gift of salvation. And so now we're talking about life and the fellowship of the believers. And in this particular frame of scripture, we're going to go through this, and it's not unfamiliar, and it might seem very simple, but sometimes, how many people know we got to get back to the simplicity of the gospel? Because a lot of people try to make it so deep, and so big, and so vast, and so huge, that it goes above the common person's understanding.
That's right.
And that's not what it was intended to do. Because we are to preach this good news, this gospel, and reach those to salvation. Amen?
Amen.
And so, when we look at this frame of scripture, chapter 2, verses 42 down through 47, we will see that there are a number of characteristics and occurrences that are happening within the early church, the body of Christ. What we will find is there was devotion. That means they were committed. That was a solemn act that they were going to commit to the teachings of the disciples, which means, okay, so now that I am saved and I have this gift of salvation, which I did not earn, how then do I live? And so the teachings of the disciples were key, and they were necessary for the people who had received Jesus so that they would know how to go forward. Because guess what? The word is supposed to reproduce after itself.
That's right.
And so the apostles who had been walking with Jesus, who had been taught by Jesus, who experienced Jesus' ministry, were now among the people, and they were so, what you would call the authorities on the word of God and the works of Jesus. And so they were teaching the people, and the people committed themselves to the teachings. You see, you gotta be in a place of commitment if you're gonna be a part of the body of Christ.
Commitment, commitment.
And so, they were committed to the teachings and the fellowship. So you had the teaching of the word, you had the commitment of the believer, the devotion of the believer. Then you have the teaching of the word. You have fellowship, we call koinonia, which yes. means we have all things in common. And then you have prayer. It says to the breaking of bread in prayers. So not only are they breaking bread, having meals and fellowship and communion, I would imagine that includes the Lord's Supper, they were also praying. Prayer is nothing simple. Simply put than speaking with God, talking to God. And I would add, and listening, because it's not all about what you have to say. It's really about what God has to say.
That's right.
And so then it says, and awe came upon every soul. And awe is reverence, high regard. We have to have reverence. We have to have a reverential fear of God. Not fear as in terror, but just respect and honor. And all came upon the people. And then we go further, and it says, many signs and wonders were being done. Signs and wonders should accompany and follow the word when the people of God come together according to the purpose of God. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And it goes on to tell us that they worshiped together. So worship is attributing worship to God because he's worthy. And there's praise. So you're praising God as well. We were created to praise the Lord. So the first church had all of these things. And there's another portion that we want to go down and look at. And it also says they attended the temple together, breaking bread in their homes. They received their food with glad and generous hearts. Gratitude.
Come on.
Gratitude is a part of the early church.
Write it down.
Being grateful. First of all, you've just been given something that you couldn't even have done for yourself. You received the gift of salvation. And so to have a grateful heart is a way of posturing yourself. It's a way of your mindset. It's a way of thinking about things. Grateful people are people who are just so thankful and appreciative for all that comes their way. And then it also goes on to tell us that they had generous hearts. when you know you've been given something that was so precious and valuable and costly that you couldn't afford it, you are willing to share with others.
Mom.
You are willing to share with others. When you understand and realize that this is something I've been given and I know I don't deserve it. I know I don't deserve salvation. So why would I not be generous to someone else? When God allows his favor to rest upon my home and upon my husband and upon my family and upon my life for things I know he did that I don't deserve, did I really deserve to be healed? Did I really deserve to be delivered? But because of that, and I know it was him, and I know I couldn't have done it for myself, then I can be generous with others.
Well,
because I'm grateful for you.
Well,
you understand what I'm saying? And then we go further, and then he says they were praising God, and they had favor with all people. People were watching what was going on in the early church. There were some outliers. There were some skeptics. There were some people who did not receive Christ. There were some who did not believe that Jesus was the Messiah. There were people who were watching. What are they doing? You already had this, the outliers in the beginning of what was happening. You're talking about, oh, they're drunk at 9 o'clock in the morning. No. The Spirit of God is being poured out upon his people as he promised, right? And so now you have that gift of salvation. And then now it's not just about just being saved people of God. It really is not. But it's also about discipleship. Because
come on.
People get saved,
come on.
They do not even know how to live this life of faith.
That's true. Yeah, that's true. That's true.
Oh, it's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing to offer that gift to someone who did not know it was even available to them, or for someone who didn't even think they were worthy of it, or to someone that God sends you to. Let me tell you about what this gift is, and to get something totally free from God that only can come from God through Jesus. So it's a beautiful thing to win souls. Don't get it twisted when I say it goes beyond salvation, but it really does. Beautiful are the feet of those who carry the gospel.
That's right.
Word. So our feet should be beautiful. We don't have to go to the salon to get our toes done for them to be beautiful.
Mr. Jeff, I got it.
You know what I'm saying? It's beautiful because we carry the gospel. We are looking for opportunities to share this good news with someone who does not know. And even for someone who does know but didn't say yes to the Lord. Right? And then we go further because discipleship is important. Because you will have a bunch of babes in Christ walking around not knowing what's required of them, not knowing what's promised to them, not knowing what they need in order to stay in. So we have to have discipleship. There has to be teaching. Otherwise, we are in a world where there are a bunch of false teachers.
Uh-oh.
We're in a world where there are a bunch of people proclaiming something that does not line up with the word of God. So you can't leave a baby in Christ just out there talking about, I'm saved and I got Jesus. You got to teach them how to live now, right?
Well.
We come up with we live this everyday life, and every day that we live, there's an opportunity for us to come up against something that we don't understand. Something that seems insurmountable. Something that seems too powerful for us. Something that makes us sad. Something that confuses us. It might make us fearful. So now I've got to know what this word of God is really all about. What is it all about? What am I standing on? What am I believing? What did God say about fear? What did God say about hatred? What did God say about shame? What did God say about lust? What did God say about adultery? If I don't know, I'm saying yes, but I now don't know how to live through this life. Can I withstand the darts of the enemy? Because I don't know that I have all of these weapons, all of this in my arms.
Come on. Come on.
I don't even know I'm an overcomer.
Come on. Yeah.
Woo. So that's why discipleship is so important.
Yes.
It's so important. I didn't know I could be transformed and renewed and delivered from these things that have been holding me back for forever. Well, how does that happen? It happens through discipleship. So we have to teach. It's important. Amen?
Teach.
So, you know, Acts 2 is the message. It's to the Jewish people. I don't want to read into it because certain truths were not revealed till later in this time. And see, we don't meet in the Jewish temple. We meet in the building because we are the church.
Yes.
And so they talked about them giving, selling all of their possessions and giving the proceeds for the help of others. Don't get it twisted or mixed up. This was not a forced act. It was done voluntarily.
Yes.
And it didn't happen over a long period of time. And if you continue reading Acts, you will see that there were some challenges about that whole thing that happened as well. And I won't get into it because we're going to take our time through this time with Acts. But for all intentional purposes, it was something that was voluntary, not forced, okay?
Yeah.
All right, and so here's the thing. It's important. These characteristics of the first church are important. And somebody might be saying, well, we all know that, Pastor. That's just elementary. What is it really? Because we have to have unity of purpose towards kingdom priorities. Unity of purpose towards kingdom priorities. So the point that I want to get to is that all of these things that I mentioned are things that are necessary, are things that are vital, and they're foundational in the early church. And what I find is, I'm finding that we are in a world where there are so many voices.
Come on, talk about it.
There are so many voices, and we need to know as the church, as the body of Christ,
right there,
what God said.
Right there.
About who we are and what we represent and who we represent. And I was blessed by Minister Lakeisha when she said, I hope I got it right, God does not create something without revealing its purpose.
That's right.
Did we not just reveal the characteristics and the purpose of the first church? Right?
Yes.
And he does not create something without demonstrating its purpose. So you see the community of believers coming together in fellowship and prayer and worship and teaching, discipleship, salvation, generosity, gratitude. So here's the thing. This, my dear good people, is the foundation of the church, the body of Christ.
Jesus.
And that it was marked by signs and wonders. When the body of Christ walks in the manner that God requires, God is glorified. Signs and wonders occur as the Holy Spirit moves, leads, and guides us. It is important to note that how we live and show up in the world has far-reaching implications. Meaning, as professing Christians, our walk is going to do one of two things. Either we will represent God well in truth, obedience, submission, and authenticity, or we will misrepresent God by living according to our own desires, motives, and agendas.
That's good.
It's one of two things. We got the foundation right here. This is the demonstration. We can see what was going on in the early church. We might not have been there, but we got this word, this powerful word of God that tells us what the foundation really is. And so if we don't have discipleship and we just have people professing and claiming Christ and still living the same way because they don't get transformed and renewed by the word, we misrepresent.
Amen.
Yes.
And you know the church always has an audience.
Uh-oh.
Whether you think you do.
Uh-oh. Uh-oh.
The church always has an audience because someone always has something to say about, well, if you were a Christian, you're supposed to be a Christian. If your God is so,
yes,
right? We always have an audience. So we want to show up as image bearers representing God well. I didn't say we're going to be perfect, but when we know what God called us to do and be and how we are to show up in the world, we're standing on something solid because God created it. I'm not standing on my husband's theology. I'm standing
right
on the word of God.
That's right.
I'm not just standing on my own theology. I have a theology because we should know what we believe and be prepared to explain why we believe what we believe.
Yes.
But I'm standing on the word of God. That's what's going to keep me settled. That's what's going to keep me anchored. That's what's going to keep me strengthened. That's what's going to keep me from falling. Right? It's the word of God. And I can go to it anytime I want to.
Amen.
And so when we walk upright, think about it. We're drawn others to us. Other people are drawn to the light. But when we live by our own standards, we repel people. It's like if that's what you're doing and that's what you're professing, I don't want nothing of it. I will not have any of that. But when you can stand on the word of God in the midst of a storm and you can go through all kind of different things, and you're still kind, and you're still grateful.
Well,
praise God, and you're still worshiping God. Somebody wants to know, well, what's that thing in you? Because if I was going through what you were going through, I would have lost my mind. I'm going through a worse thing, and I don't even know how to navigate it. And you seem to be so full of joy. What is the reason for this joy?
That's right.
How can you stand before people after having gone through what you've been through and losing what you lost?
Yes.
It's the word of God.
Thank you, God.
Anchored, steadfast, unmovable.
Well,
Lord. Yes. Yes.
And when I hear my sister say things like, I'm stronger than I ever thought, that comes from Him.
From Him.
That comes from this life that we live.
Oh, it's passing power from God.
This foundation.
Yes.
And so, why this message today? Because we go to the foundation of the church because we examine how it was formed. What did it look like? What did the people do? How did they move? What did they believe? What did they say? How did they act? How did they treat each other? Because we see then in that how God was moving. We see the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We see the role of the disciples who were leaders and teachers. We see how the community of believers operated with one another. We see the promises of Jesus that had come to pass. Knowing and understanding what the foundation of the church is helpful because it is the standard set by God. Why do you, listen, we have so many denominations. Somewhere along the line, someone has decided that what's in here has to be improved upon. What's in here has to be changed. Well, that's not what it means, and this is what it means. And someone has decided that I'm going to use this to further my own platform and my own agenda. That's just the real
thing. Yup.
Why do you think we wind up with cults?
Yeah.
Some people are fed this word with someone else's twist on it. That's the danger when you don't read the word of God for yourself. Because somebody can come to you and tell you here about anything. And if they're charismatic enough, you might be swayed into believing.
Yes, yes.
So when we know for ourselves through discipleship, through teaching, through learning, then we can stand and know, wait a minute, that's not aligning with what God set up. That's not what God said. That's not the intention of it. You know what I mean?
Yes.
And so that's why it's important for us to understand that standard that's been set. Because then, guess what? We can measure our current activities by the church's foundation.
There you go. There you go. Right there.
So
right
we don't need to improve upon what God has established. We should live it out according to the word of God. God, by his word, spoke everything that we know and even beyond what we know into existence, right? Who are we to think we need to improve upon that? God shows us in his word what the early church looks like, what the first sermon was, what the first church did, how the spirit enters into the world. Why do we think that we're so smart and we're so gifted and we're so anointed that we need to improve upon that? There are just some things that God has done that you just need to leave alone and follow suit with what God has done. Individuals and even whole ministries that they tout this thing, they promote, they talk up this thing about new and innovative revelation. What are you tapping into?
Man, come on. Come on.
What are you tapping into? Someone who says they have this special word from God. They have this innovation from God. They have this deep insight from God. And all you have to do is take this and hold it up against
you. Show it to me in the word. Show it to me in the word. Show it to me.
You do not. And don't get me wrong. I don't mean that God doesn't speak to people in ways that are profound to them. God is not in a box.
Yes.
But we have the record here.
Check the record.
So if someone comes with something, we need to really, really compare it. Look at it. Test it. And see what it is, right?
Put the word on it.
Right, put the word on it, absolutely. So the reality of it all is that the foundation that God set is more than sufficient for whatever believers and the church will need or face. What God said here is more than sufficient for everything that we will face, everything we will need, everything we will experience, everything that we will go through, everything that we will suffer. I said suffer. Because we're going to suffer for Christ's sake. But everything in this word will help us even through that.
Yes, it will.
Persecution, suffering, whatever you want to call it, the word is more than sufficient to carry us through.
Hallelujah.
And knowing our foundation and holding fast to what God has set in place will help anchor us to the word of God and keep us through tumultuous times.
Yes.
Because hard times will come.
Yes.
In this walk.
Yes.
And whoever told you that it was, yes, Jesus, I believe in this happily ever and after, didn't tell you the truth. And if you put that up to the word, you show me where someone got saved and then everything was perfect from that point until the time they went on to be with the Lord or whatever their consequence is.
Jesus.
Those are the words of fairy tales and happily ever after. But I got an anchor in Christ Jesus.
Come on.
His word that helps us, right?
Yes.
And so when we examine the world that we live in, let's take a quick look, and I'm not going to be before you much longer, but we can't despise foundational things. Right. And we can't assume. It's always good to go back and revisit the foundation of a thing, right? Because along the way in life, things happen. Things change.
Yeah.
People come. Words are spoken, experiences are had, right? And you know, life just keeps on moving. And sometimes, how many people feel like life is just moving so fast?
Yes.
And everything is sometimes feel like it's happening all at once.
Yes.
And all of that activity and all of that going and all of that stuff that's going on, sometimes you can get sort of kind of topsy-turvy, upside down, sort of out of sorts. And you need to get refocused, recalibrated, and realigned with the word of God, right? And so, let's just examine real quick the world we live in and hold it up to Acts chapter 2, the early church. And so when we examine them side by side, it's very telling. And we live in a world where many practices are contrary to the practices and the characteristics of the early church. So, we talked about the teaching of the word, right?
Yes.
There are so many false teachers and false prophets out here. There are so many voices. We don't know. If we're not anchored in the word and we're not standing on that foundation, you know, we can be swept away by any wind and doctrine. There are so many people who have so many platforms that have nothing to do with God.
Amen.
Now, it might be many gods, but it's not the one true and living God.
All right.
And then we talk about fellowship. We come together in the name of Jesus. We come together in the name of God and the Holy Spirit. You know, there are some gatherings that occur where God is not welcome, wanted, or celebrated. Jesus is not welcome, wanted, or celebrated. Holy Spirit is not welcome, wanted, or celebrated. And then some of these gatherings that occur in the world, they're not even considered. They're not even thought to be real. Now, this is in the world, right? Okay, so prayer. There are many out there right now, there are prayers to many gods, and there are soulless prayers that don't line up with the word of God. It's someone's will. Someone wants their will to be done, and so they pray to some god. But when you hold it up to the Acts 2 church, you can see a disparity. It's a wide disparity there. The two are nothing alike, right? We talked about reverence. Ain't nobody respecting our God in that culture. In a worldly culture, there is no respect for God, Jesus, or the Holy Spirit.
Right.
As a matter of fact, there's a much antagonism against them.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So when you look at the Acts 2 church where there was reverence, and you look at the world, there is no reverence.
They don't want our God.
They don't.
That's right.
And you say Jesus, you get ready.
That's right. That's right.
Because a lot of times you can say God, and somebody will follow with you until you say Jesus.
That's right.
They'll follow God. Oh, yes, brother, sister. And you start talking about Jesus and the blood and the cross. Some of them don't even believe that the cross existed.
Yeah.
And then that's where you'll have a hard, hard turn. So when you look at it against the Acts 2 church in the world, you'll see the difference. Right? Gratitude. We live in a society now where there's a lot of entitlement. I deserve this. I earned this. I need this. I should have this. You know, this should be mine just because.
Yeah.
Right?
That's right.
Right?
That's right.
And so when you hold that up to the Acts 2 church, they were grateful. They were thankful. They realized that what they were given is something that they could not have earned. They didn't deserve it. They knew it. It's the way they interacted with each other. It's the way they submitted to the teaching. It's the way that they committed themselves. And this said day by day. So it's none of this once a week stuff like we do. It was every day.
Yes.
That speaks to lifestyle.
That's right.
When the pastor and I said, we're going to start having church every day. See, I got to work, and that's not a good time for me. And
all you got to do is take Bible study.
It's hard pressed yeah. for some of us to come every Sunday. Right? So when you look at that,
that's real though. Commitment.
They did it day by day.
Commitment.
Right? And then we talk about generosity. And look at the culture now. I gotta get that. I'm probably gonna mess myself all up because I'm not really up with the latest things, but I'm gonna try. I might be like 2 years behind, but get the bag, get the coin.
Yeah.
I'm the boss. All this other stuff, right? I'm gonna get this and do this, right? Why? Why? So I can wear this. I can go wear designer labels. I can go out and drive fancy cars. What does that have to do with anything? Why do you want more? What are you willing to do for the money, the fame, the platform? And if we hear this now, I'm building my brand. What brand are you building, and for what? And what are you doing with it? Who's being helped by it? Think about it. And then it goes even further, because it's not just about platforms and money, but what about the lascivious lifestyles? With all this lewd and sexual content, and people just doing all kinds of stuff, just anything and everything goes. The lust of the eyes and of the flesh and the pride of life, all of these things. If you line it up with the Acts 2 church, that's not what the two were. They're not going to meet. They're never going to meet. These were people who sold their belongings to meet needs of others.
Yes.
You have people now that will walk and step over a person who's homeless. There have been people who have been homeless and sick who have died right in the emergency room because nobody attended to them.
That's right. That's right.
They find people who have, you know, gone through some rough times in their lives, and you find them somewhere and they have died alone. Nobody checked on them. Nobody called on them. Nobody helped them. You know what I'm saying? But this is not what the Acts 2 church did. And you let somebody be standing somewhere holding something, and people are so mean and nasty. Get a job. You're lazy. What are you doing? Now, don't get me wrong. I know there are scammers.
That's right.
That's a whole nother thing. People scamming in the world. That doesn't add up to the Acts 2 church, because when there was a need, there was a legitimate need.
Yes.
And it was met. Okay? And then, what's the other one we had? We had the generosity, salvation, and discipleship. Again, no regard for Jesus on the cross. There's disbelief. They're searching for, people are searching for a religion that aligns with their own agenda, their own comfort, their own pleasure. They're not trying to find God. Soon as you read it, there are people who literally read this word and say that God is unkind because God calls sin, sin. How does that happen? What are we supposed to do? Excuse it? What are we supposed to do? What is God supposed to do? Contradict his word so you can feel loved and wanted and accepted, and you are a liar, a thief, a murderer, and whatever else? You know what I mean? So as soon as somebody reads the word and figures out, I can't do what I want to do because this culture says do whatever God will, right? Then God is unkind and God is unfaithful in their eyes. But if you line it up with the Acts 2 church, that's not it at all, because they repented and turned. They repented and turned, and they received Jesus in salvation, and they committed themselves to discipleship. discipleship, teaching, learning. There's some in this world, in this culture, you can't teach them anything because they know everything. You can't even reason with them. So it doesn't line itself up with the Acts 2 church. So we should not be confused. When we go back and read the foundation of what God did when the first church was formed and the first believers received salvation and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, when you hold up what goes on around us every day to this word, you will see a disparaging, a huge difference in separation. And so we should even be all more firmly anchored. You know what not to do. You know what not to align yourself with. You know where not to go. You know how not to show up in the world. And so despise not them foundational things. Because how many centuries ago was this? It's still really relevant today. Right? And so don't despise the foundation. Get clear about what it is so you can be firmly. So, a lot of people make the Christian life and the church more about what it is not.
Come on.
When the church does not walk according to its foundation and all that God requires, we misrepresent God, thereby losing the opportunity to win others to Christ. And we don't want to miss any opportunity. Because the times ahead of us are going to get more difficult and more challenging. And we want to win as many souls as we can. And we want to build as many disciples as we can. It's not about filling this room. It'd be lovely and wonderful. But it's about allowing God to send you to whomever he sends you to minister and witness to them about who God is.
Yes.
Because we're coming to a time in this world where if they have no hope, they are in torment and agony and hopelessness and despair and darkness.
Yes.
We don't want to stop at just salvation because now we need that transformation to happen. We want to stop at just conversion. We want to follow through with discipleship.
Amen.
Teaching those new Christians how to walk out their faith. And when we examine the world we live in with what God set up foundationally, we realize that there is work to be done to win souls and build disciples. Amen?
Amen.
The Lord is done and I am done. And that's one of Pastor and I's prayer every day, that we will win souls and build disciples.
Amen.
And it's not for people to follow us, but it's for people to receive Jesus and to know God for themselves.
Jesus.
And then to teach them how to navigate the turbulence and the darkness and the tumultuous times. I don't know about any of you, but I know this for sure. I can't navigate through what I see in the world without God.
Amen.
And still have peace.
Yes.
Amen. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We are living. Just think about it. We have lived in some times that are just really, really out there for our understanding.
Yes.
It's nothing new under the sun because the world was. You know, there are times you go back in the Word and you read about the corruption and all the things that happened in the world, the sinfulness, the idolatry, and what God did as a result. It's old as human nature. But I'm talking about in my lifetime, in my experiences, and the things that I've seen, I couldn't have gone through COVID without God. I don't know that.
My God!
Tell it.
There were people who were really fearful. I mean, paralyzed with fear.
Yes.
The isolation caused some people deep depression. Mm-hmm. And they had nothing to call on. Some people died alone.
That's right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yes. Yes.
And so without God, how do we navigate through this life? So I'm so grateful. So grateful for Jesus and all that God has done. I'm so grateful that there's a word that lives. There's a spirit that lives in me.
Yes, God.
And it lives in you. And it helps us navigate uncertain and new waters that we don't drown.
Amen.
And we go fire. We don't even come out with a stench or smelling like smoke. That's all because of God. That's all because of Him. So we're grateful. Let's pray. God, we thank you for having a plan that's so specific and so strategic and so sound and so solid that we can stand on it, we can rest on it, we can trust it, we can believe it. We can run to it and be protected in it. So Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that these your people hold on to what you have demonstrated and what you have shown for the community of faith. Allow us to continue to look after one another and love one another. Allow us to be strong and to represent you well in the earth. Allow us to continue day by day reading your word, standing on your word, sharing your word. Let us not be distracted by worldly things, but let us be connected to you and all things that you have called us to. So, Lord, as we leave this place, whenever your presence, we ask that you continue to teach us, disciple us, grow us, allow us to learn, and to just become transformed and renewed as your word promises. And let us not keep it all for ourselves, but let us share with others this good news, this gospel, to win souls and build disciples. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.